talkative mood, and that's good. That's great. I did want to give you a special invitation to the program that we have tonight at 6 o'clock. It will be a variety of all types of music, whether they are secular or whether they are sacred or gospel or patriotic, you name it. We'll have some of it here for you tonight at 6 o'clock. So I hope that you'll be here, invite your friends, and we'll have a great time together tonight at 6 o'clock. Hope to see each of you.
I wanted to let everybody know that we are now publishing the prayer list as a separate document.
So the prayer list is out in the narthex where the upper rooms are. Also, next week, in honor of the 4th of July, we will have one service at 10 o'clock, followed by a church-wide picnic. The church is providing the meat, and everybody is welcome to come and bring a dish of your choice. We also will, the WSC Women in Christian Service will be having a book club meeting on Wednesday, July 12th. The book is Becoming Mrs. Lewis by Patty Callahan. All women in the church are welcome.
Now, if you will just take a moment to kind of take a deep breath. I know moving from Sunday school into here and trying to greet everybody just kind of gets us all going in every direction. So I'm going to ask you to please just take a deep breath and begin to prepare your hearts for worship. And I'll lead us in an opening prayer. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Lord, what a wonderful gift it is to be able to breathe in your presence that is in this room. I pray that you will prepare our hearts now to be touched by you. And that as we leave this place, we will leave knowing that we have surely and truly been in the presence of the Lord. We pray this in your name. Amen.
pleasure to have our woodwind choir with us, and I certainly appreciate the effort that Charles puts in to have this group with us once a month. I know some of these youngsters just graduated from high school and will be off to college, so we'll probably start seeing a few different faces up here perhaps, but I know Charles will have a group here to be a part of our service on a regular basis. Good to see you this morning. Take your hymnal, turn to 531. We sing all stanzas. May we stand as we sing.
Creed. You'll find it on the screens. I believe in God the Father, the whole maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Yeah.
may be seated. Before we bow our heads for a moment of prayer, I want to ask the ones that just graduated in our Wooden Winds, would you please stand and turn around and face that way so they can... Congratulations. I got in trouble after the early service for not knowing which ones of you graduated, so I said, well, I'll have them stand in the late service. But congratulations, and know that we'll be praying for you as you begin a new journey and a new stage in life. I also ask you to continue to pray for Chester. He is doing better and getting stronger, but let's pray that that continues as he moves forward and he can get back home and back in church as soon as possible. And also Millie Canning, I saw an email early this morning that she had a TIA, so lift her up in your prayers during the days ahead. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Oh Lord, we are so grateful that we can come into this place and gather together with as one family and be surrounded by your presence. And Lord, how faithful you are that not only do you meet us here every week, but that you walk with us each and every day. You are there to sustain us, to strengthen us, and to guide us through life. And you showed us that guide in your Son Jesus, who stepped down from heaven and put on flesh and became and dwelled among us, who lived each and every day in the middle of life so that you can relate to our pains, you can relate to our worries, our fears, our anxiety, our struggles, and our joys as well. And what a gift it is to know that our Creator, the God of the universe, wanted to be that connected to us. So Lord, we pray this morning that you will open our hearts and you will take us by the hand and you will draw us closer to you so that you can make us to be the people that you've called us to be. But also, Lord, as we move in closer to your presence, we are reminded even more of our shortcomings. So we stop in this instance and we confess to you our sins. But as we have confessed our sins, Lord, I pray that each of us will hear you whisper in our ears, my child, you are forgiven. But Lord, also create in us a heart that offers that same measure of forgiveness to our brothers and sisters. Pour your Holy Spirit out upon us. Send us out into the world to be your messengers, to share your story with those who are lost, those who are hurting, those who are struggling, so that they too will come to know the loving, powerful presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus. And Lord, we do lift up to you those we have called, these young people here who are graduating and beginning a new journey, part of their step in their journey of life. Lord, we pray for those on our prayer list and for those we name in our hearts. We pray that you will place your healing touch upon those who need healing, that you will give strength to those who are weak, that you will give peace to those who are struggling. And as always, we pray for the leaders of our country, the leaders of our state, the leaders of our community, and the leaders of this church. Lord, we pray this and we ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, thy name, kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. We forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
It's not conservative or liberal, however they're defined. It's not about interpretation or the judgment of the mind. It's the opposite of politics, power, and prestige. It's about a simple message and whether we believe. It's still the cross. It's still the blood of Calvary that cleanses sin and sets the captive free. It's still the name, of Jesus that is bound to save the lost. It's still the cross. We can water down theology and preach a word to suit our needs. We can justify sweet subtle lies that are wrapped in noble deeds. We can alter our convictions to adapt to social whims, but we cannot change the gospel or the truth contained within. It's still the cross. It's still the blood of Calvary that cleanses sin and sets the captive free. It's still the name of Jesus that has won to save the lost.
It's still the cross.
Oh, simply say it's not religion or ancient history. The cross of Jesus still remains the price for sin that sets us free. It's still the cross. It's still the blood of Calvary that cleanses sin and sets the captive free. It's still the name of Jesus that has power to save the lost. It's still the Children's Church, please feel free to leave after the offertory prayer. There will be someone at the back of the sanctuary waiting for you.
Now let's take our hymnals and we turn to hymn number 15, our offertory hymn. We stand together as we sing stanza one.
Father, we thank you for all the gifts you have provided to us. Please bless these gifts we return to you and use them to allow us to be your hands and feet in the world. In your precious Son's name we pray. Amen.
How he could love me, a
unclean. For me it was in the garden. He prayed not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. How marvelous, how wonderful my son shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows. He made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. When with a ransom in glory his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful my song shall.
Thank you again, Mary. You know, I don't think we realized how blessed we are sometimes with special music and all of our music. And, you know, tonight will just kind of be a celebration of that. So if you'll want to be here for that, because it will not only be awesome musically, but I got a feeling it'll be pretty funny at times as well, too, because I think the comedian Richard Livingston is going to show up and have a stand-up comedy routine. This Sunday, we are in the fourth of the Beatitudes. Now, we'll take next week off and then come back to the Beatitudes after next Sunday and go forward. But we are at the fourth of the Beatitudes, which is, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Now, some translations say they shall be satisfied. And I don't know that I like that word better than I do shall be filled. But you know, satisfaction is a hard one. It's kind of one of those things that constantly elude us, and because it's something where when you get everything exactly right, no matter what it is, there's that instance that it's right, and then there's that instance that you want something else. We have a whole industry that's devoted to creating that something else for us. It's called the advertising industry. I mean, their aim is to highlight our dissatisfaction with something and to offer us a solution. They have a product that can fix everything in the world. Politicians, they've kind of developed this thing. You know, you hear it in every politician. Well, my opponent has made things bad. Your life is awful. But if you elect me, I will make things great. And we kind of go into that sort of back and forth. It's so interesting. There was a company, Market Watch, which conducted a series of interviews with both financial experts and happiness gurus. And they identified 7 reasons for unhappiness. Not having enough money. A significant increase in prescription medications. Too much time spent with smartphones and other gadgets. Stress. Jealousy. Jealousy over those who seem to have more. A 40-hour work week is one of those things that makes us unhappy. And being physically unhealthy. Just this morning I read a headline that said the key to happiness is spontaneity. Just do what you want right now without thinking about it. You know, that's funny. They came up with 2 underlying themes in this study. It says, first, the experience of happiness is all about now. The now is what matters, not what might come in the future. And the second one, true satisfaction is temporary. So brief that there is no such thing as lasting satisfaction. Adam Hamilton, in one of his books, calls this the restless heart syndrome. I don't know if you've heard of that, but you've all heard, everybody heard of restless leg syndrome? You know, that syndrome where your legs constantly twitch or have contractions. Well, he says restless heart syndrome is like that. There's a twitch within our heart or our soul. Its primary symptom is discontent. We can never find satisfaction in anything. The moment you acquire it, you scarcely take time to enjoy it before you're searching for something else that will bring you that happiness. It's we go on social media and we create something or we see something that we've seen on social media, and before the paint dries from that creation, guess what? We're looking for something else. It used to be you bought a new car and you drove it off the lot, and it didn't take long for the new car smell to last. The new car smell lasts longer now than our satisfaction with that new car. We drive it off the lot and we see another nicer version and we want it too. See, it's just when we see that moment that we think we found satisfaction, that you open your computer and it's been listening and it pops up and the new, the latest, the greatest is on sale and it's ready for you to view. Envy and discontentment are just a part of our lives. It's so much a part of our lives that it's become prevalent not only in the world but in the church as well. I mean, you know what I'm talking about. You join a church, you get involved, and then all of a sudden you think you found the perfect church, and then you realize there's no such thing as perfect. You begin to see the warts, and I mean, the preacher said something in the sermon that kind of hurt my feelings, or so-and-so didn't smile at me as I was walking in the back door, or or you know what? I volunteered to serve and nobody ever called and asked me, so I'm going to go down the road and find that perfect church. And several years ago, it was a bunch of years ago now, we had some friends that their teenage daughter got aggravated at the church and told her mom and dad she was going to find the perfect church. And they handled it perfectly. They said, go on. She went and visited other churches, stayed gone a couple of months, and then she started coming back with mother and daddy. And I asked her, I said, what's going on? She said, there are no perfect churches. There is no perfection. It's constantly moving, constantly out there. I mean, teenagers are struggling with their parents. They're dissatisfied with them. Parents are dissatisfied with their teenagers. Husbands are dissatisfied with their wives. And we know wives are dissatisfied with their husbands. Employees with their employer and employers with their employee. This restless heart syndrome, this struggle for satisfaction, this struggle to fill the hole in our soul is real and it's alive. So what is the cure for restless heart syndrome? See, I believe it's found in this fourth beatitude. I believe it's found in the word that Jesus gives us here when he says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. You know, what does righteousness mean? What in the world is Jesus saying here? You know, because I think righteousness is kind of the key word in that phrase. It's and in Matthew's understanding of God, it can also be translated as justice or as just. And Matthew would say the word actually means to live by the law, God's revealed will. Yet Matthew tells us that Joseph, in the first chapter, was a righteous man. Joseph, the one who did not follow the letter of the law, when he heard the news that Mary was pregnant, because in that moment, the letter of the law was what? He could have had her stoned to death, put to death, but Joseph decided to quietly divorce her and let it go away. So Matthew is trying to tell us that righteousness is living life in a way that respects both the law of the Bible and the call of Jesus Christ in our lives to love our neighbors, even if it seems to be in violation of the law. See, Joseph is a righteous man because he chose to live with a heart for God, for God's will and direction, instead of living by the letter of the law. You know, so therefore this righteousness is living out the character of God in our life. And it's not just the vertical relationship that we have with God. It's a horizontal one as well. It is seeing the pain and suffering of our brothers and sisters and reaching out to them in the love of God. Righteous are willing to stand up for what is right, no matter what the cost is. It's this kind of righteousness that comes in only one way. It comes because it's not about what we do. It's about whose we are. Listen to what Paul says in Romans 4, 3 and 5. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who is without works, trust him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. You know, it's this kind of righteousness that leads to a new way of living before others. Jesus taught us that that's what he wanted. He, as a matter of fact, was very critical of a righteousness that brought piety in the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And he said that righteousness is something that is found in the quietness of our heart. It is found in what God sees within us, not what act we put on before us. So I want you to hear this. Righteousness is not perfection. It's not being perfect. Righteousness is only found in our desire, our hunger and thirst to be right in relationship with God. See, hunger and thirst are powerful words that Jesus uses here. We struggle because none of us really know what it means to be hungry. I mean, yeah, I realize it's 11:38 and you're getting that twinge. You know, I told them in the 8:30 service, I mean, I get that twinge about 9:15 on Sunday mornings and I start thinking I'm a little hungry. So that's why Ronnie and I look like vultures walking up down the hall going to Sunday school, Sunday group to Sunday group. We're looking for who has the best food so we can decide where we're going to lie and we can feed. I mean, that's what we do, don't we? We're blessed in this country. We may get a twinge of hunger, but we don't know what it's like to be hungry. Not those of us sitting here in this room. And we definitely don't know what it's like to be thirsty. I mean, you need to notice what's here. I get a little dry. We take a drink of water. But in Jesus' day, hunger was a real thing. As a matter of fact, most of the people listening to these original words understood not only hunger, but they walked that thin line between hunger and starvation. Most of them were day wagers. They basically worked for less than a dollar a day. And I don't care how you add that up. Even if you take away 2,000 years of inflation, that's still below poverty. You didn't get fat being a day laborer in Jesus' day. As a matter of fact, most people in Palestine, they had meat once a week. At the very best. They were very close always. They were on the edge of starvation. And let's just look at water in the desert. In the arid country around Palestine, probably every one of those travelers had been caught in a desert storm. You know, one of those wind storms that blew so much wind up your nose and down your throat that you were sitting there almost suffocating, and you were in that moment where you needed a drink of water so bad that it didn't matter. And there's just no parallel for us. See, Jesus is saying to us that we need that kind of desire, that overwhelming passion, that we need to desire righteousness with the very every bit of our very being. So I want you to hear it. The key takeaway for today is this. It is not that we achieve righteousness, but it's all about us desiring righteousness. So how do we cultivate that desire for righteousness in our lives? You know, I thank Colin Smith because in his book, Momentum, he lays out five ways to cultivate that desire for righteousness. And so I want to share them with you. It's number one is to gain momentum. The book's titled Momentum. I guess he's selling books. But think about it. Remember back in the first of these series, I said to you, the Beatitudes aren't meant to stand alone as statements. They're really a progressive kind of building on one another statement. Remember, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. So you can't start with four and just say, I'm going to get to there. You've got to go all the way back and allow those to kind of build within you. And you've got to become poor in spirit, to mourn your sins, to submit your life to Jesus. And then, and only then, can that desire for righteousness be developed within you. And the second one is to practice fasting from legitimate pleasures. Now, I have to admit that when I first read that, I quit listening, because you say the word fasting and I just shut you down, because you can look at me, tell, I'm not going to miss a meal. But I went back and really read through it again. Practice fasting from legitimate pleasures. I can remember as a child that we would come home from school and we would be starved to death, and mother would tell us not to eat too much because it would ruin our supper. And we sort of wouldn't. If she didn't catch us, we would, because we were three boys and we would eat anything in the house that didn't move. But sometimes you'd eat so much what you couldn't eat supper. And so snacks in the middle. And you know, there's nothing wrong with our pleasures. There's nothing wrong, golfers, with you playing golf. Hunters, fishermen, ladies, shopping, or you know, whatever y'all do, you know, all your hobbies that you enjoy. There's nothing wrong with those things. I'm not saying that. So let's just go ahead and get that out of the way so I don't get in trouble. But what he's saying is to periodically give up one of those pleasures. You know what it is? It's really about control. Because I'll admit, late in January, if I hadn't killed the deer, hunting becomes a controlling factor in my life. Mac, you better say amen to that, because you've been there. But, you know, it's, can I give up those things that take up so much of my time? And then can I replace them with time spent in God's presence? See, we talk about giving up things for Lent, and we all do it, but usually we spend a month and a half thinking of something we can give up easily. But the truth of it is, when you are fasting, you are surrendering something in your life so that you can replace that something with searching out for God's presence in your life. I think that's what Jesus is saying when he says to the crowd, if any wish to come after me, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. And then the third point is, make yourself vulnerable to the needs of others. I mean, how do you work up a good appetite? You either exercise or you work hard, and then you go for a walk, or you go for a run, or you spend the afternoon mowing the yard or doing whatever you do, and then all of a sudden you come in at night and you're ready for a good meal. Well, you know, the same principle is true in our spiritual life, that spiritual nourishment of our souls. I mean, how many of you have been on mission trips? I know I don't ask you to raise your hands much. Now, how many of you have been on a mission trip and you made a great impact on everybody that was there? Or how many of you have been on a mission trip and it made a great impact on you? You know, when we give ourselves away to others, when we find ways that we can serve, when we extend ourselves in serving others, it's in those moments that God works to kind of work on that hunger and that thirst within our souls. It's nourishment for our souls. It's what Paul is saying to Timothy in 4:7, train yourself in godliness. It's those moments in life where we are training ourselves to be ready, to be open to God, and allowing God to cultivate within us that hunger and that thirst for righteousness. And the fourth one is, use your blessings and troubles as incentives to feed on Jesus. Colin Smith shares a point here by a guy named Thomas Watson on how we can stimulate our spiritual appetite. He noted there are two things that make us ready to eat a hearty meal. The first is exercise. That seems pretty obvious to me, but his second answer, Colin Smith says, surprised him. He says there are two things that invoke appetite. One is exercise, and two is sauce. You heard me right, sauce. I know, Linda, I had that same look. But now you got to know, Colin Smith is from England, so if I lived in England, I'd have to have a lot of sauce on my food to survive, because the food I've had from there needed sauce. But, you know, I listened to him and I started thinking about that. I love barbecue. My wife accuses me of knowing every grocery store that serves barbecue in the whole state. But I have found out one thing. Everybody can cook a Boston butt. And most people can do it about the same. And the truth of it is, when they pull it apart and put it before you, that Boston butt tastes the same wherever you go. But what makes it different? You want to know what makes it different? Johnny's barbecue sauce is the best barbecue sauce you have ever put in your mouth. It's in Coleman, Alabama on 31, and I can't go by it without stopping. And what I realized is that all of us, I bet every one of you are out here thinking, now wait a minute, I got a bone to pick with him because I know somebody else's. But sauce is what sets it apart, isn't it? Well, see, it's that sauce in our life. It's those sweet blessings, that sweet sauce of blessing that God gives us. Those blessings that God lays out upon us in our life that kind of reminds us of how God is working. But it's also that sharp sauce of our troubles or that hot sauce of our persecutions that increase our hunger and thirst for righteousness. If you turn to the Gospel of John, you read a story of Jesus coming to a portico and he sees a man who had been lying on a mat for years and years and years. He couldn't get in the pool and heal himself. No one would help him. And Jesus heals him. And Jesus tells him to stand up and to take his mat and to walk. And I have never been able to figure out, why did Jesus tell him to take his mat, that symbol of all those years of suffering, with him? And it hit me. That's that sauce. That's that reminder. That's that reminder of what's going on in his life. That reminder that helped to increase that hunger and thirst for righteousness within his soul and within his life. And the last point is this. And you're going to think this is correct. Trust Jesus for your growth. Now, I know you're all thinking, well, now, wait a minute. I trust Jesus. I mean, you know, it's amazing to me. We trust Jesus, don't we, to forgive our sins. And for some of us, we know there are a lot of those that need to be forgiven. We trust that Jesus forgave our sins and that because of Jesus, we're going to spend eternity with our Heavenly Father. We have no problem with that. But when it comes to spiritual growth, when it comes to sanctification, when it comes to living this life here on this earth and becoming like Jesus, developing that character in our lives, we think, that's not going to happen. I'll admit it. When we were ordained, they laid their hands on us and said, they asked us the question, said, do you expect to reach total sanctification in this life? And every one of us said yes, but then we snickered. You know, it's funny to me how we can trust that Jesus can forgive our sins and he will take us to heaven with him, but we don't trust him enough that Jesus can and will work in our lives and make us into the person that God called us to be. You know, it's a powerful aspect. It's moving us beyond that hopelessness that we feel, and it's recognizing that we can be that person Jesus wanted us to be. and that he is there calling us. Listen to that verse. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. They will be satisfied. They will have it. Do you not hear it? Jesus is calling us. He is inviting us. As a matter of fact, listen to these words that Paul writes. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely. And may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. That turned my hopelessness into hope. I know now that there's a chance that I can and will be that person that God wants me to be. I can and will develop his character here on this earth. He is there to help me. How about you? Do you hear it? Do you hear the hope in those words? Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Amen. This altar is open to anyone who would like to come forward and have a word of prayer. The doors of this church are open to anyone who would like to unite with this church. And maybe you're sitting out there and you've never experienced that hope. And God's been pulling on your heart during these last minutes or the whole sermon. And you're sitting there saying, well, now I don't know that I want to make that trek. Well, guess what? This altar's open and he's calling and it's here for you as we stand together and sing.
More love to thee, O Christ, more love to thee. Hear thou the prayer I make on bended knee. This is my
be seated for just a second. I want to introduce to you Laura Stafford. Right? Did I say it right? Yes, to offer. And now I've gone blank, Becky. Becky Smith, you said, she said, you pronounce my last name Smith. And I said, I can pronounce your last name Smart Ellie. And then I forgot it.
I've known him for a long time, y'all.
Well, I'm going to ask you both, do you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Will you support this church with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Well, then we're glad to have you and love you both. Love you too. Now they're going to stay up here so y'all can come get your hugs, but I told them I got the first one. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.